At this point, I want to review a few of the airspeeds that we've talked about. So we're going to go through each of them and then talk a little bit about some of the implications of the equation and the different parameters that play into those airspeeds. So let's consider first the minimum power airspeed, so the V sub mdv. Okay, so this was kind of a hairy equation. So we had 2 divided by square root of pi e ra cd naught l plus the square root of pi e ra cd naught l squared plus 12 pi e ra cd naught. I'll insert the square roots here. And then all of that is multiplied by w over sw, which is our wing loading, divided by rho. Okay, so this was the minimum power airspeed. And we also had talked about the minimum drag airspeed, which is also the minimum thrust required airspeed. And we did an approximation for this where we assumed that CD naught L is close to zero. And we came out with this equation. Square root of 2 divided by the fourth root of pi e ra CD naught that's all under the square root multiplied by the same factor, the wing loading divided by the density. Now I want to just remind you of a couple things. E, of course, is Oswald's efficiency factor. R sub A is the aspect ratio. And our CD naught and CD naught L are terms in our parabolic expression for the drag coefficient as a function of the lift coefficient. Okay, there's one more airspeed that we touched on briefly, but we didn't really go into detail on, and that's the stall speed. So this is what we call Vmin. So this is a minimum airspeed below which, if we fly at any airspeeds below it, we'll stall. Okay, and the way that we obtain this is just by taking our maximum allowable lift coefficient before stall and then solving for the velocity. And what we get is square root 2 divided by CL max, where CL max is your maximum lift coefficient, divided by root W over SW divided by rho. Okay, so the first thing you'll notice here is that we have this term hanging off the end of each of these airspeeds, this W over SW divided by rho. Okay, so the wing loading factors into all of these. And then our minimum drag airspeed and our minimum power airspeeds, we have also pi ERA CD naught L and CD naught. Okay, so really what we have here are airspeeds, two of which are functions of Oswald efficiency factor, the aspect ratio, CD naught L, CD naught, and then we have our wing loading, which we're going to keep together, this W over SW and rho. Okay, I think I've caught all of the, and CL max for the stall speed. Okay. Now, I just want to talk a little bit, though, about what each of these things mean for the airspeed. Okay, and the way that we look about this is by examining how much these things can really affect the airspeed, or how much freedom we have in changing any of these parameters to get the airspeed requirements that we want. Okay, and the way that we do that is by looking at typical ranges of these different things. So I'm gonna go into a different color, and we're just gonna take a look. I'm just gonna make a little chart here. So we're gonna have our parameter. We're going to have kind of like a max range. And then we're going to have typical range. Okay. Okay, so we're going to have, we'll start with Oswald's efficiency factor, E. Okay, so E, Oswald's efficiency factor, is a parameter that in theory could range from 0 to 1. Okay, but on aircraft, the range that we see, the largest range that we really see is something between like 0.7 and 0.95. So it's not a huge range, but the typical range that we see on aircraft is even smaller than that. Okay, normally, in fact, Oswald's efficiency factor hovers around 0.8 for subsonic aircraft. Okay, so it's pretty well. It's very small, okay, the range that we typically see. Let's talk about the aspect ratio now. So the aspect ratio, of course, there is a large variety of aspect ratios. If we're talking about like military aircraft, we could have aspect ratios that go down to 4 or 5. These are delta wings. So the aspect ratio could fall somewhere between like 4 or 5 and could go up as high as in the 20s. For like sailplanes. So if you're familiar with these different types of aircraft, sailplanes have very high aspect ratio wings, and that tends to give them really good low speed efficiency. Now, this is a pretty large range, but on typical general aviation aircraft, what you'll see is that the aspect ratio usually ranges between around like 6 to 8. Now, certain commercial aircraft have aspect ratios probably around 10, but it's very rare to see an aircraft other than like a sailplane that has a higher aspect ratio. Okay, now let's look at CD naught L. So CD naught L, you'll recall, is usually very small, and for most aircraft ranges 0.01 to 0.1. But a more typical range that we generally see for most aircraft would be somewhere between 0.02 and 0.05. So again, it's a pretty small range. I'm going to go down just a little bit. Let's look at CD naught. So CD naught, excuse me, we're going to skip CD naught. Let's go to CL max, actually. So your CL max, this is a term that is the maximum lift coefficient for an airfoil. So you have it, or for your aircraft. And this is generally dictated by the airfoil maximum lift coefficient. So your airfoil, as a function of angle of attack, will reach a maximum lift coefficient before stall begins. And once stall begins, the lift coefficient drops. So really, you can't get a higher lift coefficient. And for thin airfoils, this can be as low as 0.8, or it could be as high as 5. For airfoils that have leading or trailing edge flaps that are deployed in a high lift configuration. So again, that's a pretty large range. However, in typical operation for most aircraft, you'll find that the maximum lift coefficient usually ranges between 1.2 and about 1.5. Okay, so the typical range is much smaller than maybe the possible range. Now let's look at wing loading, okay? So W over SW. So wing loading is the weight divided by the wing area. And wing loading ranges really between, it can be anywhere from 1 to 100. And this is typical. Okay? This isn't just like a max range that can be. We can see lots of examples within this range. So this is a large range, and what this tells us then is that when designing an aircraft to meet certain airspeed requirements up here, it's really beneficial for us to be able to manipulate the wing loading, because we can change the wing loading and get changes in our airspeed requirements. And we have a much larger range that we can play with than some of these other parameters. So really the wing loading becomes the kind of the go-to thing that designers will tailor in order to meet airspeed requirements.